There are over 400 known species of sharks in our oceans today. In general, they're very difficult to study, but what we do know about sharks is that they're extremely evolved. They have a sophisticated sensory system that outclasses most modern military submarines. They're known to be intelligent, curious, and perfectly adapted to their aquatic environment. Despite the fact that oceans cover 70% of our planet, most people will live their entire lives without ever seeing a single shark.
My first shark encounter was in the Red Sea when I was about 3 years old, and it was a time when I still couldn't use a snorkel. So I had to swim on the surface and always take my head out of the water, grab air, and then look. It was so amazing, and I got so excited that I swallowed a lot of water while going up and down, trying to get a long look at the sharks. I only seen them in books and stories my dad told me.
If our stories about sharks excite our imagination, imagine what stories the sharks could tell.
You could describe a shark as the lords of time, the ancient but successful fish that has been around for half a billion years. You have an animal that is as highly evolved in that side of the world as a human is in this side of the world.
Contrasting sharks and humans may take you to some interesting places.
Today I say that people are less predictable than sharks. You know, people used to say that sharks are not predictable. That is not the case. I can tell by the way they swim which direction they will swim next. I have a perfect understanding of their body language, which is a language you have to learn.
But in this age of pop culture and modern media, this is not how sharks are being portrayed.
Well, as a child, you always have a wrong history of the sharks because of the bad movies, White Shark and all that. And in the meantime, I found out that the sharks are one of the most important animals in the world, which are responsible for the ecological balance in the oceans.
The ocean has evolved with sharks for half a billion years. And we know that sharks, as top predators, they balance the biosystems below them. The biodiversity is handled by sharks, period. No sharks, no coral reefs.
You have a beautiful coral reef and you take the reef sharks away, it takes about a year for that reef to die. Because as long as the sharks are there, there is no waste in food. And the minute the sharks are gone, other predatory fish will multiply. But there's so much food left over that the green algae and jellyfish and everything moves in. And the little fish who eat the green algae, which saves the reef, will be eaten by the other predatory fish.
Recognizing the true nature of sharks and the significant role they play is important. But it's difficult unless we first acknowledge their intelligence.
Sharks doing a certain kind of classical conditioning task, they learned it faster than rabbits or cats. And the cats and rabbits were doing the same exact task, and they learned it 80 times faster. These are not dumb animals. Without having been in the apparatus for over a year, they remembered immediately on trial one that they knew what they were supposed to do.
There are some that are so impressed with the shark's intelligence and behavior characteristics that they directly draw comparison with one of our most revered and trusted land animals.
Body language in the animal world is universal. And when you think about working with large animals, it doesn't take much to influence their thought or their body. And this is exactly what I found with sharks. To me, that demonstrates an enormous amount of intelligence.
In addition to possessing innate and learned intelligence, sharks exhibit some very surprising behavioral characteristics.
One of the very interesting characteristics of sharks, they're predators, but they're flight animals. This is very much like a horse, and very much like you and me. Humans are this way. To watch two humans enter a horse pasture is the same as to watch two humans enter the water with sharks. If done with the right attitude and the proper approach. These animals will open up to you and relieve themselves of this fear or flight instinct. And then you're becoming part of their environment. And then they begin to learn from you, which is a wonderful, fascinating thing.
While sharks come in all shapes and sizes, the largest shark, the whale shark, eats one of the planet's smallest creatures, plankton. And although people often use the term aggressive to describe sharks, the sand tiger shark is one of the shyest in the ocean. Some sharks display a measurable social hierarchy and when swimming around food, portray the opposite of a frenzy and are almost hypnotic to watch. But despite their superior intelligence and sophistication, sharks are in peril because of fundamental human instincts and an out-of-date tradition. Evolution has earned sharks many advantages, but they are at this moment facing risk of extinction because of two insatiable human needs. One is our desire to experience fear served up through entertainment, and the other is our need to hold on to an age-old tradition, the lingering vestige of an overthrown aristocracy. People come from all over the world to have fun at Universal Studios in Orlando, Florida. Among other fantastical creations, they can experience rides like this one. This is the Jaws ride, and it's frightening, dramatic, contains elements of humor and surprise. While the emotions we feel are real, the experience is rooted in fiction, delivered by a theatrical shark, not a real one. Through the exploitation of our most primal instincts, it's entertainment like this that shapes our opinions and leads to inaccurate perceptions.
The vast majority of people have either never seen a shark in real life or have seen a few on television. And the way television is nowadays, most people get the opinion that the shark is the death fish from hell.
With creative camera angles, fast editing, and a bit of teasing, filmmakers easily portray sharks as frenzied and out of control. In this fabricated, hyper-excited state, they serve as antagonists to our survival and induce terror in our audiences.
I had that because you heard so many bad things about the tiger sharks. The size, the scavengers that would eat anything, license plates, rubber tires, anything. They would probably eat a guy like me too. And then when I saw the shark, my fears vanished immediately because I could tell that the shark was just curious and was not at all out to get me.
The idea that sharks are out to eat humans is supported by a perception that sharks are nothing more than mindless eating machines.
Sharks are on a very strict feeding regime. They feed every 3 days, so any 100-pound shark would try to eat 3 pounds in one feeding and then not feed again for 3 days.
The fear of being eaten was an essential emotion of our successful ancestors. But of all the activities we're involved in today, people are at very little risk of being eaten by anything, much less a shark. To put it in perspective, the Mother Nature Network prepared an infographic about sharks that portrays 5 things that are more likely to kill us than sharks. It turns out that we're more at risk from falling coconuts and vending machines. This is even the case for those who spend their lives on the ocean.
Of all the large animals in the world, sharks kill the least amount of people. If you think about the billions of people who swim in the ocean every year worldwide, and of those, maybe 50 to 80 get bitten by sharks, and less than 10, normally between 4 and 6 people die.
A fatality in any sport or activity is terrible, but people who regularly swim with and interact with sharks are not concerned that the sharks will prey on them.
The shark is still a predator, will be a predator, even if it gets hand fed, and a shark will never associate a diver with food in the sense that it would consider a human a prey. The shark knows exactly what is his prey. It's either a fish carcass or a wounded fish or a fish, but it's not a human.
These experiences directly contradict opinions that sharks actively prey on humans. While a predator-prey relationship exists, here's the irony. Humans are the predators, not the sharks. We're killing over 70 million of them every single year. And one of the most wasteful uses is shark fin soup.
The best thing would be that shark fin soup would be forbidden worldwide.
You know, when you think that these animals are being killed mostly for 5% of the body, because the fins make up 5% of the body, and you throw back the animal into the sea, first of all, it's a waste. Secondly, it's very cruel. And third, it is just to satisfy some people who believe and think that shark fin soup is a delicacy.
Now, this is totally inappropriate. You cannot destroy the ocean to make soup. I don't care how rich you are. That just doesn't make sense. And it's okay if you're the king and only the king does it, or the emperor, which is what used to happen. But now everybody's a king, everybody's an emperor, and sharks are being swept from the sea. It's just totally inappropriate.
The cultural item cannot be very important because the average Chinese cannot afford this soup. A bowl of soup can easily cost between $50 and $100, so the average guy in the street cannot afford that. The emperor and the high nobility, they were allowed to eat shark fin soup. Nobody else ate it. So it was something special for nobility. And they're all dead. They've all been killed.
I've eaten shark fin soup when I was young. And I know that shark fins have no taste whatsoever. They have no nutritional value whatsoever. They're just being considered a luxury dish. And if you don't use a chicken stock or a fish broth, it is totally tasteless. So you ask yourself, why do they do it?
I'm not telling the Asians what to do with their culture, but at some point you have to take a stand and say, no, you're not going to destroy these top predators that hold the whole fabric of the ocean together to make soup. And it makes no sense.
You know, when you go back through history and you look at some of the brutalities that the human race has inflicted on itself, it's awful. What we're doing to sharks is another one of those brutalities on an equal scale. Finning, shark finning, is a practice which a fisherman will remove a shark from the water, chop its fins off. It's literally with a machete or a very sharp knife, and the body is flailing around as it's suffocating in the air. Once all the fins are removed, the fisherman kicks the shark off the ship, and it sinks back into the water where it can then again breathe, but it now can no longer swim. It falls to the bottom where it dies a very slow and tragic death, a complete waste.
This tragedy happens every day. By most scientific estimates, sharks are being killed at a rate such that many populations are becoming unsustainable. The very survival of sharks is threatened by humans, and yet in spite of this, every day, sharks touch humans in profound ways. There are people who fear sharks. There are people who persecute them. And there are those that support them from afar. And then there are people who enjoy a special connection with sharks.
So I combined my spearfishing hobby with shark watching, and it was very easy. Every time I shot one or two fish, sharks would appear. First, quite cautiously, they would circle me, and eventually would get bold and take the fish off the spear. And that's how I really started to get closer to sharks, and where I could observe their behavior. It was a growing learning experience.
Some special connections with animals lead to even more connections and strengthen existing bonds.
Where other people have a backyard, our backyard was really literally the ocean. I went diving at a very early age already with my father. My first real touch moment with a shark was with a nurse shark. And they're usually very, very docile sharks. And they usually allow themselves to be touched as well. And then in South Africa and diving with tiger sharks, that was just an incredible experience, just because it's such a large shark and a shark that usually has been portrayed as one of the, you know, man-eaters, supposed man-eaters. And really being able to connect with one of those impressive large sharks, that definitely left a mark on me.
Merely swimming with a shark has the power to dispel myths and create lasting bonds. But what if it completely changed your life?
I was first touched by a shark when I was probably about 8 or 9 years old. I was fascinated by fish, and I used to go down to the docks, and somebody had caught a great big, what turned out to be, in hindsight, a bull shark. That got me interested in them. And then I was a spear fisherman back in the 50s, and I was down there spearing, and a huge hammerhead came, and I thought, you know, I was going to be eaten. I was menaced. Of course, it didn't even look at me. I mean, it had just passed by, but that was enough. I got in there in the cave with the grouper, and it just passed by. It wasn't that interested. That changed my whole life. That summer, I asked my professor, could I study sharks? And he said, yes. He said, you definitely could. So I changed from pre-med to marine biology, and my whole career went in a different direction because I was touched by this hammerhead shark.
Such is the power of sharks that just 30 shared seconds can change the course of a young person's life. But does that power have the same impact when we get older?
I got into diving very late, you know. My daughter Philippa kind of got me interested in it. At the age of 60, I learned how to dive. So when I had to jump into the water the first time with a shark down there, I said, do I really have to do that at my age, you know? But once I was down there, I just loved it. And I fell in love with the sharks. It's a great feeling to swim together with sharks. To me, it was the most exciting thing I've ever done in my life.
This power and excitement surely speaks to our souls. But what would you do if you discovered you could communicate with sharks in the same way you do with other animals?
One of my first interactions with a shark that was just spectacular was when I'm on a shoot. We're on a technical dive for a pilot for a television series. I get down, the shark is about to enter my frame, and I say to the shark, you can't enter the frame, we only have one shot at this. And I actually used one of the equine techniques that I would use to send a horse away. And when I used that technique and held my camera on my subject, and the shark circled around and understood it, it was an aha moment for me when I thought, this shark can understand body language, it can understand energy, it can understand intent, and it blew me away. From that moment on, I started playing with sharks on a different level, besides just appreciating them as a beautiful, wonderful animal that moves quickly and sleekly through the ocean, that's the apex predator controlling all the eutrophic species below it. That didn't matter anymore. Now, I'm looking at an animal that I can actually communicate with and have a special relationship with.
Touching a shark with your heart and soul is one thing, but is it possible that these big sharks want to connect with you too?
When we arrived at Tiger Beach with the boat, then all of a sudden they were screaming, there are sharks, there are hammerhead, and tiger sharks, and lemon sharks, and everybody put the gear on and jumped into the water. Usually when I heard this, say there are sharks in the water, people get out of the water. In this case, everybody jumped into the water, so I thought, okay, I put my diving gear on and I jump also into the water.
There are some animals that will ignore you if you ignore them. But that's not always the case with the more intelligent and curious ones.
The last day of our diving trip, I went without the scuba dive gear and just with snorkeling. At that moment, I saw that one of the tiger sharks down came directly up to me. And because I was lying on the water, on the surface of the water, so the shark came closer and closer. And then I said, what should I do? If I swim away, I'm going to lose, because the shark is faster than I am. And that's why I then just didn't move at all and waited what's going to happen.
Life is full of defining moments. Moments when you recognize the truth. Moments that can open your eyes and force you to question what you think you know.
I was thinking that the shark will not do anything to me. It might push me a little and then go away. And so I waited, and then I felt the push, and then I also felt that I was shaked back and forth, so I knew that I was in the mouth of the shark, and then the shark got away.
Sharks have their taste buds under their palate, so they have to take everything into their mouth before they decide whether it's food or not. Tiger sharks are scavengers, so they like to eat something that's already half dead. Then they don't have to spend energy by killing it. I filmed this, and I was so nervous when I saw this. I dropped my camera and went up, and I thought this person needed help. And then I found out he had 14 holes in his dive suit, but he was not hurt at all.
Well, I developed no anger against the sharks because I was behaving wrong, not the shark. The shark was curious and wanted to find out if there's something to eat.
Close encounters like this are extremely rare. While Folkart was unsure how to avoid this encounter, he did not panic or struggle. This, combined with a merely curious shark, surely helped shape the outcome. We'll never know precisely what the shark was thinking. This experience graphically illustrates that just because sharks reach out and touch us with their mouths doesn't mean that we humans are their food of choice.
I learned to realize that sharks are not dangerous, at least not as dangerous as one thought. And today, after so many years of diving with sharks, the passion is at its peak, I would say.
Swimming with sharks is an exhilarating, soulful experience. And as divers around the globe become more enchanted by sharks, they inevitably learn more about their plight. If we didn't think sharks were monsters, if we didn't think they were out to eat us, surely we would do more to protect these magnificent animals.
The everyday person should join one of the organizations for the protection of sharks. I'm one of them. And they all try to protect the shark. The shark is not a bad animal. Sharks don't eat people, but people eat sharks.
But if more of us don't take immediate steps to protect these sharks now, it will soon be too late. And the world as we know it will be altered forever.